the leaflet. This is possibly the best kept secret been kept from you up till now, but I hope that from now on you're going to tell not only yourselves, but your friends who come. We've got a very exciting program, even for the rest of the year, even though you've missed most of it. And on Thursday we've got Duchess of York, next week we have Goldie Hawn, and we've got some other extraordinary people. I see Henry Windham, the chairman for somebody's a long time. Newhouse, who owns Condé Nast, the real boss behind many famous magazines like Vanity Fair and so forth. Mr. Smith, except that she's not here. We've had about 9 to 5.
Shall I apologise now or in a minute?
No, in a minute. We can't apologise enough, that's the point. Nick Jones, the founder of Soho House. In the 96 interviews I've had no cancellations. Today, I have half a cancellation. I'm very sorry about that, but James, who is his real name, but Mr. Smith did tell me his wife was unable to come because she's in New York, but I'm sure that you will speak for her. Now, the format is very simple. I have a conversation with Mr. Smith, House main speaker, for about 10 minutes, and then I want you to ask him questions. Make his life difficult if you want, but they've got to be intelligent questions. If they're not intelligent, you'll be sent out of the room. They're really fun. The idea is to give you, the audience, as much chance as possible to interact with our main star. And this series, the Prudential series, is really to invite people who have led extraordinary lives or done extraordinary things, so that you, who are not so successful, can actually emulate.
I think we've been before, just so I know what the repeat rate is on these.
My first question to you, I mean, we're going to find out exactly how to set it up, but I want to ask him straight away how successful his business is, because often a lot of people hear about extraordinarily successful companies. And I can tell you, for example, that, what's that company called? Sells all the stuff, that sells all the stuff. Amazon.com doesn't make any money, right? Facebook doesn't make any money. Now, does Mr. and Mrs. Smith make any money?
We make some money, yes.
How long have you been in business?
We have been in business since 2003.
2003, so that's what, 13 years?
Yep, but the real business started in sort of 2006 when we developed from being a guidebook into a travel club, as we call ourselves now. So that's when it sort of pivoted.
How many offices do you have?
We've got London, LA, New York, and Singapore.
Lots of staff.
Yes, about 120, roughly, something like
that's
that.
That's quite a lot.
It's more than enough, yes.
Yeah, so even the £30,000 and your £3 million of salary go every year.
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah. And so how much do you make?
How much have we made this year? Oh, it depends how you look on how much you make. I mean,
we don't have to answer.
We'll make about £1 million this year.
Oh, Christ. Yeah. And so you're going to be very rich?
Our shareholders are relatively happy with what we're doing at the moment, that's for sure.
All of us want to know, because all of us want to dream of something, because it's a highly competitive world. This new generation of online business. Some people succeed, a lot don't, and I'm sure amongst us all, including myself, we have tried to become the new Facebook or Google or whatever, and we suddenly find that it's a lot more difficult than that. Now, you started in 2003 as a guidebook, but in 2006, you probably cleverly decided that the internet was the future. Is that the case?
That was the case, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I wouldn't say cleverly. It was all through our lovely members telling us that they loved our guidebooks, but they didn't want to cart them around to work, and they were getting caught trying to look at holidays while they were busy at work, and so they wanted them online. And so it was really in response.
So they can pretend they were working on it.
Precisely, as we all do. No, of course not. But yes, exactly.
You track the time when people
a spike actually at 9 o'clock after the wine has started flowing. People start to hopefully be a little bit more frugal with their cash. We have a lovely spike at 9 p.m.
Today, would you say that Mr. and Mrs. Smith was a guide for the luxury end or a bit more than that?
We've always positioned ourselves, I didn't think that the world needed another luxury business, so we've always defined ourselves as boutique, and we've always tried to be an aspirational brand, absolutely, but also very accessible. There's no pretense to the brand. That's why we called it Mr. and Mrs. Smith. I don't know how many of you know why we would have called it Mr. and Mrs. Smith. Apologies if any of you thought Brad Pitt was turning up from the film Mr. and Mrs. Smith. I'm always a huge disappointment, particularly to our American audiences.
That came later, right?
So well, it is hard battling Angelina and Brad, I have to say, but I don't know what year. I didn't track it, if I'm honest. But
does anyone know
why we're called Mr. and Mrs. Smith? So Lucy, but you've already met me, so that's unfair. So I'll tell everyone else who doesn't know. So when you were out of wedlock after the war, and obviously I'm not that old, but you know, when people were going away for weekends, as we Brits would call dirty weekends and the best possible taste, even if it was someone you absolutely loved and were hoping to marry, it was really frowned upon. So people would sign in under a pseudonym, which is Mr. and Mrs. Smith, which was the most common name in the English language, and that's why it's called Mr. and Mrs. Smith. It's our nod to couples anonymously going away together on those weekends, or romantic weekends away together.
Why did Brad Pitt call himself Angelina Jolie?
Well, again, they called it because they obviously had this mysterious second life when they were just seen as a suburban couple, when actually really they were spies. Was that you and me? I don't know. But Mr. and Mrs. Smith, what's interesting is that every country has their own Mr. and Mrs. Smith. So in France, are we going to be French in tonight? Any French? So the French claim to have invented the dirty weekend, it's Monsieur Mademoiselle Dupont. In Italy, it's Rossi. So everyone seems to have their own Mr. and Mrs. Smith. Well, it's a little bit more tricky in those countries because you have to give your passport in at reception. So you can start as Mr. and Mrs. Smith, and then you have to tell them exactly who you are. So it doesn't quite work as well.
In China, we also have Mr. and Mrs. Wong.
Is it Wong? Yes.
Wang King Wong.
Okay, we're trying not to say that again. So yes, anyone ranking ones, and it's also a Mr. and Mrs. Smith term.
How do you make money?
How do I make money? This just goes straight to it. So it's really simple. So the hotels, we personally, so I don't know how many of you actually know what we do, but we go out and we curate what we believe are the world's most beautiful boutique and luxury hotels. And then we put them on our website. Now that costs money to do that, but what we ensure is that we personally visit every single property, and then we send a couple away, a tastemaker couple, someone such as yourselves, incognito, who stay there for 48 hours, and really check that everything that we've seen is perfect. If that then checks out, we then charge them a fee to go onto our website, and then
you spot a hotel,
yep.
You then send in your spies, and they come back and they say it's fantastic.
Yep.
You then write to the hotel and say, now look, listen, we think that you qualify to be on our one of the 10 best kept secret hotels in the world. And we have in fact sent in a couple of spies and they both confirmed that.
Yep.
Now will you give us £10,000 for us to put you on the site and be recommended? That's more or less what happens.
Essentially, then we charge a commission on every booking that we book through us. So our website is obviously.
So out of 100%, let's say, how many say yes and how many say no?
It's 98% say yes. Really? People want to be part of the collection. It wasn't like that at the beginning. I was on bended knee begging hotels to join the collection in the beginning, but now it's a lot easier. We have about maybe 500 hotels a month trying to join. So we have to have a standard automation.
You only have the top 10, don't you?
Not top 10 necessarily. There's no fixed number, but it has to be what we perceive to be the best.
I mean, I went on site the other day just to test. It's quite difficult to get into the top 10. Mm. Is it deliberately so?
Not necessarily. It shouldn't be difficult. It should just
so
be.
So today, what's the most luxurious, what is the most beautiful, I noticed that you have the most beautiful bedroom in the world.
Sexiest bedroom in the world.
Which is the sexiest bedroom in the world?
Well, right now? Yeah. Well, the I can't say right now because the awards have only just been launched for next year, so we are now looking for the sexiest bedroom.
What was last year?
Last year? Good question. I think it was one in the Amalfi Coast, remember? I think it's Bellevue Seren, which has its own swimming pool in the bedroom, if you fancy that.
So there you go. Indoor swimming pool.
Indoor swimming pool at the foot of your bed.
Yeah. Are you sure it's not a fish tank?
I'm almost certain it wasn't a fish tank, yeah.
But I think there are swimming pools at the end of the bed in the Maldives, but yeah, in the American, that's quite good.
It's quite unusual.
But surely, that might be considered a bit vulgar.
Well, it's not just done with effortless style and taste, absolutely not.
I mean, you know, if you have a pool at the end of your bed,
I mean, it's not an Olympic size pool, it's more of a plunge pool.
I know, okay, but if it is a plunge pool, then how do you dry yourself when you want to fly onto the bed? Because it's very difficult to have sex in water. It's a biological fact.
Yeah, it is a problem that comes up in our reviews regularly. Something that our scientists is working on about how to have sex underwater. Yeah.
And what were the other categories? I mean, the sexier bedroom. Yeah.
We try to have fun as a brand. You know, I think we were the first company that wasn't another luxury hotel guide, which is why we called it Mr. and Mrs. Smith, which is why we can have the world's sexiest bedroom, which is why we have Date Night Bar as one of our awards. Date Night Bar. So the best place to go for a date. You know, these are the things that matter. You know, I have this horrible vision of very sort of grey-faced hotel inspectors going around on their own with white gloves, checking for dust, and telling us how we should be experiencing our hotels. And it just didn't add up to me. So that's why we wanted to mix it up and really change the way hotels are reviewed and the way we talk about them. Hotels are about going away and having the most amazing, wildly romantic, hopefully a little mischievous time with the one that you love. And that's what the tour is about.
Or democratic, are you? I mean, do you have a panel? No. Website, or is it just you and your wife?
No. For the awards.
No, we
have judges. We have judges from all walks of life. So again, our tastemakers, our influencers, for want of a less pretentious word, it's really difficult to come up with one, are all people who are not trained hotel inspectors. They're artists, they're chefs, they're restaurateurs, they're DJs, they're diamond dealers, they're whoever we think are interesting folk who go away with their other half and really tell you that insider story that you want to know. Because so many guidebooks in my early years, which is why we started the company in the first place, were the most drab and boring reviews, usually written by one person, usually telling me where I should be playing golf with my wife or my girlfriend, usually trying to head me towards rock formations on tops of hills that were deeply underwhelming after 3 hours of trekking there. And we just wanted to do something different, and that's what Mr. and Mrs. Smith is all about.
And would you say that you are curatorial service as opposed to a trip advisor, say, which depends on the opinions of Mr. and Mrs. X?
Yeah. I mean, I think that sort of user-generated content obviously is the buzz for everyone, but I don't know about you guys, but I don't trust a lot of my friends with their recommendations. I don't know how many dinner parties you go to where the lights are on full, there isn't a candle inside, the music's dreadful, the food's fairly crappy, and then I'm going to take a recommendation from them. I love them, don't get me wrong, but it's not really their area of expertise. And I think the problem with TripAdvisor is I'm sure all experienced that someone might be on a TripAdvisor review on their hotel that's the best hotel that they've ever been, but they're not a spoiled bugger like I am, who've been to a few more, who might know one or two things more in terms of standards of hotels.
If you were recommending, giving us free advice as to the best date, night, hotel, sexiest bedroom, romantic evening, where would you go?
Where would I go? Okay, so depends on your budget.
London.
Depends on what sort
no
of stuff.
Budget.
No budget, blow the budget,
yeah,
anything you want.
Anything you want.
I still really... Honestly, I've got nothing on, my phone's off, everything's good. I still really, really like Blake's Hotel. I don't know how many of you have been there or stayed there, but it's sort of 50 odd bedrooms. It's the original sort of boutique hotel.
Which room?
The Cardinal Suite.
I think that is definitely the most romantic bedroom in the whole world.
Well, it's just pure fantasy, and it's fantasy in a tasteful way. This isn't some sort of dodgy Ann Summers hangout. This is a beautifully designed...
Except it has nowhere for you to put it on.
Well,
I mean, Alicia Hemphill is a genius, but not practical. You can't.
Yeah, but you know what? I don't think mischief has to be practical all the time. You know, this is about having a wildly romantic evening with your other half. And
who knows the Blake Hotel?
And only to Blake's. Blake's is
who
the
knows the Cardinal Room? Well,
you will now.
Please.
Yeah, okay.
But it's you should go to that. I promise you, if you cannot seduce somebody in the Cardinal Room, then you might as well have a physical examination. There's something wrong. Okay?
It's the only hotel I know that has a discreet back entrance where certain well-known people leave by as well.
Yes.
Which I like, and I like.
You're speaking from
I like what kind of goes on tour, stays on tour, and you know that's it's just. I think as people, we are still.
Who is which other is this good? We need to know which is a good bar to pick up a girl or take a girl.
I'm happily married and couldn't have things like that at all today. But there is
the wife is not here.
Yeah, forget it. There's so many great hotel bars. The one I really like at the moment, particularly for the drinks, are the Zetas. Do you know the Zetas at all? The newer one in Marylebone is fantastic.
Marylebone, where is that?
Marylebone. It's sort of south. It's not that much north. Yeah, it's just south, isn't it? Well, it depends which part we're talking about.
North
Regent's Park is just south of.
It's definitely north of the park. Yeah, I mean, it's north of Marble Arch. I mean, that's pretty
north.
Marble
Arch, yes, just north of there. Yeah.
North is the little.
But it's very good, and the cocktails are phenomenal, so there you go.
Do you love your work? Do you wake up every morning and you say, I'm so happy because I'm doing something that I love and I'm making lots of money?
Not always, no. I don't know. I'm not going to lie to you and say that it's all wonderful.
What would you like to do and have Mr. and Mrs. Smith change in order to be much better?
Okay, that's a really good question. I think one of the challenges I've had as a was young entrepreneur, now slightly older, I'm 45 and a half, I'm counting halves now because it's getting on a bit, and I'm trying to slow down time. I think when you're young, all I cared about was just growing the business, and we took on a fair amount of investment back in the early days, and you didn't really care about shareholdings and share structure, because it's like having a child. You just want it to be the best it can be, and so you just try to do everything you can to get it to where you are. Then if you get a little older and maybe you settle down with someone and have kids, you start to regret some of those former decisions. And I think that's the only thing, if I'm being really honest with
you. Well, you mean giving away too much equity.
Yeah, exactly. And although I still have control of the business, as you get older, there are opinions are great, you know, everyone has one, but quite often I think it can become, when the business gets bigger, it can become a bit too democratic sometimes. And I'd like to probably take more control of the business if I could.
So who is your competitor?
So many people now. I mean, it's ridiculous, the landscape. Well, there are so many companies. Unfortunately, we do have to battle with the big sort of online travel agent giants like Booking.com and Expedia and TripAdvisor, which was just a review site.
You'd like to kill them all. That
if I could fun. Kill all of those people, that would be excellent. Google as well, the Do No Evil Google are on my shit Ooh. List at the moment. They're awful people. They're not from Google. I'm sorry, I don't like you. You were meant to be about search, but you're really about search and buying, and you want to control everything, and travel is your new pet, which you're playing with.
Alright, so you identify the problem.
I'm bitter about Google, in case you haven't recognized that I'm not happy about what they do.
Well, as Eric Schmidt, who was here, having a conversation with me, he will come back next year, but you identify the problem. So what do you do? How do you add value to Mr. and Mrs. Smith in order to identify yourself as something different?
Again, excellent question. What we try to do is really elevate ourselves from the pack by positioning ourselves as a travel club. So we call ourselves the Travel Club for Hotel Lovers. And it's all about, I think clubs are places which should hopefully look after you. They shouldn't rip you off. They're places where you'll have kindred folk who will be members with you. And clubs should work hard at trying to deliver you service and great deals and great offers and not give you any of the sort of bullshit that a lot of other companies will do.
On last minute bookings, don't you?
Sorry?
Last minute bookings.
Yeah, we do a lot of last minute bookings, but also we're trying to get advanced bookings. Any booking's a good booking as far as I'm concerned, but it's really about service. You know, you'll hear this time and time again. I think in an online world, we've tried to remain on and offline, so we've very much taken a high-tech, high-touch approach. So you can obviously book all our hotels through our website. website, but you can also call our travel team. And it's a proper expert in-house travel team who have visited our properties. And they're based between London and LA, and they're really there for you. So if you do have a problem, and it's a big problem, it'll even get to me, you know, we will sort it out. And if you have a booking with another company, I can assure you they won't go to the ends of the world, but we will to make sure you're happy.
Afterwards? Well, during.
I mean, things can go wrong. You know, someone might get that room overlooking the car park that's disappointing, or maybe the head chef's just left, or the general manager's changed, or things are fluid, things are always moving.
What happens if in the middle of the night you get a phone call saying that somebody's been put into a room where somebody had committed suicide the day before,
yep.
And there's a blood stain?
Yeah, what would I do? Yeah. Well, so, any questions from the floor now? I mean, we do get extraordinary. I mean, we got a call from a client in South Africa asking us to get a dog to stop barking because they were keeping them awake, which was an interesting one. And we do get extraordinary requests from some people. I mean, occasionally, and I do take the view that customers are generally always right, but once or twice, there are certain customers that get passed around us, sort of luxury travel agents, where you have to say to them very kindly but firmly, I don't think we're the company for you, because they're either quite completely mad or their expectations are just too high for anybody ever to meet. So,
okay, good. We've got 20 minutes gone, so I don't want to...
We did all right.
Other than the fact that you didn't answer two questions.
Oh, did I not?
Okay.
We'll come back
to the blood and your real net worth. percentages in the company, P&L, balance sheet, a lot. Now, who wants to ask Mr. Smith a question?
Yes.
Okay, very quick on the mark.
Hi.
Can you use the microphone, because everything's recorded and you can watch all our program.
We've been recorded as well.
Of course. Yeah, you're recorded and you can watch all these things on YouTube, unless you object. Now, if you don't get Mr. Smith, but we would actually be asking you to pay a fee. I'm really joking.
Hello.
So you were saying that people love hotels.
Yep.
But we know that people also love homes.
Yes.
So what are you doing about that? Because there are a lot of strong players in the market.
There are.
Like One Fine Stay,
yes.
Which was recently acquired by Four Hotels.
Four Hotels,
so
yeah.
We know that hotels are also...
Yep.
What are you doing about that? How are you approaching guests and prospects, leading them to hotels rather than to homes?
Excellent question.
How are you competing with players in the market like One Fine Stay?
Okay, so Airbnb, One Fine Stay, fantastic companies, big fan of both of them. But we are a different proposition.
I'd like you to just
question. Don't go any further.
Airbnb and One Fine Stay are quite different.
They are, yeah.
So Airbnb is
more
a
smart
answer the question.
But that wasn't the
case. Yeah, but Airbnb is more mass market and a marketplace business, whereas One Fine Stay is more of a curated hotel property, which is trying to act like making your home a hotel, I guess. So which one would you like to talk about? One Fine Stay. Okay, so One Fine Stay, brilliant business. I don't know if any of you know.
What is it called?
One Fine Stay. Bit of an average pun, if I'm honest. It's not as good as Mr. and Mrs. Smith. So that's
what is the pun? One Fine Day.
Yeah.
From Puccini.
It's not that good, is it?
Man and Butterfly.
I'm just saying. Anyway, but let's get past that. They have just sold for $120 million, so you know they're doing something right.
I'm really irritated.
I think it's brilliant, you know, disruption's a fantastic thing, and a lot of these...
So what does One Fine Stay...
That's my word in edgeways. What does it do? So, if Mr. and Mrs. Smith was to be Airbnb, it would be One Fine Stay. It curates homes, your homes, my home, whoever's home is good enough for them. But what it does, unlike Airbnb, is it offers a full concierge service, as well as changing all the sheets, all the linens, putting bathroom products in, and giving you a concierge service while you're staying in London, Rome, New York, wherever it might be. The challenge they have as a business is the scaling of it. If you imagine you have 1,000 homes in London, I don't know about your home, but my home has loads of sort of quirks and things that, you know, you have to do this to the dishwasher and this to the heating, and if that doesn't work, flick this switch. So if you imagine you've got 1,000 homes, and you've got all these customers arriving, all wanting to know how things work and aren't working properly, whatever. The actual actual the scalability of the product, in my opinion, is a big headache. So that's the first challenge.
You mean the expense of creating?
The expense of actually trying to manage those customers in 1,000 different homes, essentially.
How can they sell themselves for 120?
Because they're a threat to the hotel business. And I think that, from my perspective, again, they're not a threat to my business, because our business is about unique properties. I think if you're a middle-of-the-road hotel, I would really be frightened right now, more frightened about Airbnb than I would be about one client stay. But it means that hotels have to up their ante. I've stayed in an Airbnb and a one client stay property. Both are fantastic. The problem was, I don't know about you guys, if you've stayed in other people's houses or rented them when it's not a professional organization behind them who are kind of renting it as a business, when you arrive, you get met, you kind of have a look around, you're still absolutely having to clean up your own stuff, try and find all the sort of gizmos and gadgets in the kitchen, which takes me at least 2 days to become familiar with. I stayed in this one house in LA, beautiful, amazing couple, had the perfect family from what I could see from nosing around. And but they were short, and I'm quite tall and quite big, and their bed, my feet were hanging out the end of the bed, and the pillows weren't very comfortable, so I didn't sleep very well. It was nearly as expensive as a hotel. It was great that we could have all the family in one unit, which was perfect, but it didn't quite tick the boxes that you have with a hotel. So for me, the only downfall with Airbnb one might say is you're still having to clear up your own mess, and you're never going to quite get that sort of luxury and indulgence that a hotel's going to give you. And for me, hotel visits are all about getting away from it all and being looked after and being pampered. And you know, it's nice to have some staff around for a change.
I never, when this whole concept came out, I thought that the problem wasn't so much that clients wouldn't get dissatisfied, but owners. I mean, if I lent my own home out, I'm sure everybody would say that Nick can't be stuff that I've got.
Anything valuable you put away, but you're skeptical. I think generally the premise of these companies is that 99.9% of the human population are decent. And I did leave a little room. And most people don't have crazy parties and steal things. Of course things happen, but generally no.
Yeah, 1 minute. Yeah, okay. Wherever I go, all right, you can speak, and then you. Two people with beards.
My question for you is, do you see a future of any M&As or any partnerships with food and drink or restaurants or broadening up
your career? Yeah, I mean, food is unquestionably the biggest and most important factor in hotel bookings right now, I would say. Apart from sort of the experiential travel side of things, which people are talking more and more about, but
to customers to have
really interesting food going beyond what we used to have. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the pigs. Do you know the pigs? Have you heard of the pigs, the piglets? So the pig is probably the most booked countryside hotel. There's four of them now, I think, four piglets in the UK. They're working at well over 90% occupancy, and we've all had the kitchen garden. Which you know about, but they've introduced the live kitchen garden, so you can pat the pig or milk the goat, and then you'll be either eating or chewing on the cheese the next day from whatever they've been doing. And it's all about us sort of urbanites who desperately want to get closer to the provenance of food and products and be a part of it all a bit more. And I think that the change in the way that we eat and the interest we're showing in what we're eating is phenomenal, and that's reflected in everything from farmers markets to hotels. Another big trend I'm seeing with food is, in the old days, again, kitchens were always put at the back, you know, through a swing door, you wouldn't see anything at all. Now the kitchen is being brought front and center. You're seeing the meat hanging in designer fridges. There's a hotel called QT in Sydney where they had a 6 foot tuna hanging in a glass refrigerated cabinet where they would be carving sashimi off. So it becomes the theater of the hotel as well. So this whole kind of being immersed in food and the food going now beyond where Michelin took us, which got a little bit too fussy and foamy and smeary for my likings, is a real trend we're seeing in hotel restaurants at the moment.
So this restaurant called Pig, you go there,
it's called the Pig,
and then you follow it to the slaughterhouse.
You won't follow it to the slaughterhouse, but potentially the bacon they'll serve in the morning will have been reared by them on their land, absolutely. And they grow all their own products. They have a rule of nothing can be served within beyond a 15-mile radius of the hotel as well. So it's, you know, it's really innovative, and it's like catnip to us city dwellers at the moment, and it's doing phenomenally well.
Right, first bit.
Thank you. James, what are your thoughts on the
answer. I'd like to think we'd be huge. I mean, we were.
He obviously wants to do it.
We were fortunate. We did ride this sort of boutique sort of wave that was happening. I know it's so overused now as a term, but it's hard when Google defines it from an SEO perspective to change that now. I'm seeing trends moving on from that. So the private house hotel is the next trend that we're seeing, which is even more intimate luxury. There's the most fabulous place in Stockholm called Etem you must go to if you have time, where you feel like you're in your sort of very well-to-do, glamorous, wealthy aunt's house being looked after by her and her team and her staff. You can go into the kitchen, go back to your food question, and you can order what you want. If you want beans on toast because you just arrived.
I stay there.
It's fabulous. Or you can plan a 7-course tasting menu if that's what you wish the next day. So this flexibility within small hotels is something that I'm really excited about. There's another one in the Cotswolds called Fox Hill Manor who have just followed a similar suit. And these are some even beyond sort of luxury hotel experiences that I think we're seeing. So going back to your question, if I was going to launch something today, everything I've ever launched in my life has been about, I have a couple of rules. So first of all, I think it's going to have a really good name. So is it a name that's hopefully going to resonate or make you smile or hopefully you're going to remember? You need a killer name. Again, in my opinion, it's not a must, but I like having a name that I'm really proud of and like talking about that has genuine roots and a story behind it. The next thing is it has to be PR-able. Because if you don't have a product that people are going to talk about, and I'm talking PR in two sense, the most important PR you can get is from people, such as us, yourselves, talking amongst yourselves. If it's something that captures your imagination, you will share that. In my day, when we started, we didn't have social media. We'd share at dinner parties, if you remember those, and we'd share around the water cooler and that kind of thing. Now, sharing through social media, is, you know, you can explode a business quicker now than you could back in when I started, absolutely. So you've got to have a great name, got to be incredibly PR-able. And then the other thing I would tell my younger self now, I would look more more hard-nosed at what the actual business margins are and how difficult competitor landscape is and how you could be crushed by Google if you're not careful and always trying to keep one step ahead of the game and all those things. So there's kind of my slightly less entrepreneurial sort of jaded side that I would mix with that original sort of let's go and fix a problem, let's go and do something no one else has done before, let's go and shake things up a bit. That's what I would look to do.
Margin is something which everyone forgets.
Yes, well I didn't even have a plan when I started. Critical. I didn't even think about margins.
Yeah, it's absolutely critical. Beer too.
Hi James, so in the early days when cash flow is probably slightly less to what it is today,
yeah,
did you still bet the hotels? And if so, at what point did you actually charge them to get onto your platform?
Do I still bet the hotels personally?
At the time when you started, obviously, you had less cash.
That's why we set the business up. I wanted to travel the world tax-free. That was the main reason. We charged the hotels just exactly the same way as what we always have, really. I used to visit every single property with my wife, which was fantastic. And then the business grew and we had to scale, and so we had to teach other people who we thought were good enough to curate the collection for us. But the safety net and how I sleep at night is that we have about 1 million members around the world now, and trust me, if anything's wrong, I hear about it. We hear about it quickly. And what we'll do is we will go and re-anonymously review, and if we agree with it, we just stop working with the hotel. So, you know, we're as rigorous as we possibly can be with this. We thought it'd be nice to set up a company where we only work with hotels we love, they're really good at what they do, the customers have a great time, and maybe they'll just come back and do it again without having to go through Google. And that's really, you know, my life's ambition right now.
All right. The lady with very good hair.
Excellent hair.
If I understood right earlier, you said your company, you're expecting about 1 million profit this year,
yes.
Right?
Yep.
So as an entrepreneur, I'm putting myself in your shoes as an entrepreneur, is it satisfying or is it frustrating to have a brand that has such an incredible reach, so strong, so beautiful,
yeah,
1 million members in the community, yet just 1 million in profit?
Yeah,
and
it's
how do
really
you,
frustrating. Yeah,
so how do you approach the future for that?
Yeah,
you have a big plan that you can share? Or
I'll tell you a story, it does keep me up at night. So our members are brilliant, I love our members, they're incredibly vocal, and we sent out the most mundane survey you could possibly write, talking about where they travel, Bookings.com might be cheaper for all sorts of reasons. They may ring the hotel thinking they're going to get a better deal, even though we have agreements with the hotel who we see as our partners, that they can't sell the product any cheaper than us. But people's perception is that they might get a better deal with them. So they'll ring the hotel, see it's the same deal, and then book it with them anyway. So we have a huge amount of sort of seepage wastage that we don't capture right now. And again, if I was to tell my former self when I'm setting up a business, trying to find a defensible sort of core to your business is hugely important. And we are essentially a middleman. And that's a great place to be in one way, because you don't have big assets that you have to buy, etc. But you're very vulnerable as well, because you don't own the asset. And I don't think I would ever have another business again where I don't actually own the asset or own the technology that facilitates the asset, for example, Airbnb or One Fine Stay, or even own the inventory for a while, something like Secret Escapes, which I'm sure you all used. They actually, for that moment in time, own that inventory. And that's something we don't do. And so it's something that we struggle with and try to address all the time. And we do that through a number of ways, as I mentioned, service, we have loyalty schemes, all these sorts of touch points to try
and
hopefully
to work. I mean, what you're referring to is something like a management company. I mean, Four Seasons, they don't really own it, they're a management company.
Yep.
They sell 24 times earnings.
Yep.
I mean, that's one of the highest.
But you can only get the Four Seasons, yeah, it is their product, that's what they own that.
And the other one is eBay, or where they are a trader. And Christie's, Sotheby's, they're all trading companies. They don't own any assets. They are at the mercy of things owned by other people.
But you can't buy that product on eBay from any other leading.
No, what I'm saying is that the company, you're worried about not owning whatever in control of whatever assets. You don't need to. Because if you're a trading company, the best trading company is a balance sheet where it's zero.
But the difference with the ones you quoted, eBay, you can probably only get that product through eBay at that point in time. So therefore, they own that customer. Whereas if you try and book Blake's tonight, you can book it at Blake's and you can book it at 10 other OTAs. And that's the challenge.
But have you not thought about giving an incentive to people who book?
We do. You get a gift on arrival.
And half your margin.
Yeah, you get a gift on arrival, which is like a bottle of champagne or something like that. You get a bit of money back in your loyalty account. All these things we do, which is why we built a partially successful business. But you're right, the brand has always punched a lot bigger than the business, if I'm honest. And if we captured the entire business that I know that we bring to the hotels, I would be nearly as wealthy as David, and life would be good.
Yes, the gentleman with another beard, which is brewing a stubble.
You've got a bit to go before a beard, I think.
Thank you. There must be a lot of travel bloggers in the world these days. How influential...
Did I hear that correctly, sorry?
Travel bloggers.
Bloggers, I think
yeah.
So, buggers. I'm not sure about that term. Bloggers, yes, there are a lot of bloggers.
There are a lot
of
those as well.
There are a lot of bloggers.
So my question is, there must be a lot of these bloggers there. How influential are travel blogs and review sites like yours for marketing luxury and boutique hotels?
I think now, obviously, they're hugely important. I think the marketing departments don't still fully recognize them, or the finance departments certainly don't, because tracking their success is still very difficult. You know, we all have clever attribution tools that allow us to apportion a certain amount of our marketing spend to sort of the black hole of marketing, which is PR and influencers, etc., which we can't track. But for me, it's very important if it's done in a credible way, because again, go back to my original point to you, anything you create, you need people talking about it. And these bloggers and Instagrammers and whatever it might be, are people who, if they're credible ones, will only work with you if you are genuinely a brand that fits with theirs, otherwise they're affecting their own brand. So we try to navigate through the horde of influencers and bloggers that we genuinely are fans of, that we work with, and that's how we work. Because I still think there needs to be some integrity in those partnerships, not just buying numbers, because numbers don't mean anything. You know, sizes of databases don't mean anything. It's nice for me to quote a million people, but it's about how many people are actually actively booking with me, repeat booking with me, what they're spending with me. Those are the important figures. I saw Nick Jones.
What are those? What are those figures?
Sorry, what are those? What all those figures?
Well, you've got a million. You've got a million.
We have about 100,000 very active customers.
What do you think of Nick Jones's place?
Well, Nick Jones has delighted that it's more expensive than.
when clubs were still worth joining. Now, you open a club, I mean, there are 100, 200 restaurants to go to. You almost don't have to.
Yeah, but I think he's been very clever in the way that he's managed to roll out what feels like a very familiar yet global brand. It recognizes its locale, but you do feel instantly at home. And I think when you're traveling, and it's very much for that terrible marketing term, whoever came up with it, the sort of leisure traveler, we are on business, whether we're in LA or Miami or London or whatever it might be, but we want to go somewhere where we feel like we're being looked after. And that goes back to that club sentiment that we're trying to do more
virtually. We were at his Malibu club, which apparently only allows people who live in Malibu to join. I mean, really snooty about it. And
you know, it's impossible. You know that, yeah, he's coming up before you say
it. Yes, he's okay. He's a good friend. I like to tell the truth to my friends. You have to be a megastar or somebody incredibly recommended to get a table there.
Yeah.
But at 10 o'clock, the whole place is empty. I don't know if
that's an exception rather than a rule. I mean, I've been kicked out of many summer houses far too late. I think they're brilliant. That's what they do. I think you're going to your question about the farmhouse. I think that's a much bigger project. It's almost like town planning. And I think that was more of a challenge for them to get right. I think it still has to grow into itself.
I kind of understand the farmhouse is that you are not allowed to drive up to the entrance. So a cripple like me, I was ordered to park my car in a car park. And they walk half a mile up the entrance.
They don't want to block the landscape with cars, they want to try and keep it.
But they do have cars in front. Anyway, I mean, the whole place is not that pretty anyway.
I do agree with that, I hate to say, but you're right. I don't think the actual farm is the prettiest farm I've been to, is my thing. So that would be, I'd agree with you on that.
The lady here, and then a Chinese girl.
Oh, sorry, I was looking that way. You're not Chinese.
No. Are you Chinese?
No.
Yes.
Sorry.
Is that I can just phone? Yell.
I can't believe you didn't switch your phone. Classic.
Is that better? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah.
I can hear you, but I'm... Can everyone else hear?
Can everyone else hear?
No, is that working for you? Can you hear?
Okay, I'll just...
Let's just keep really going. You've got a good loud voice, go on. Keep going.
Good. So I'm interested in your thoughts on the solo traveller. I find that that's a really underserved market. I know your brand is...
It's difficult with our name,
that.
I know. I don't mean to
but
be asking
the
solo traveller.
Being in the industry, I just wanted to hear your thoughts on whether you think that's improving the next opportunity.
It's difficult. I'm not...
Do you always travel? Let me just ask you, do you always travel solo?
Pretty much.
I'm not an expert on solo travel. Many hotels obviously don't get the same yield from solo travel in terms of their rooms. A lot of our hotels are small and they need to get every penny they can. So there aren't many single rooms anyway, if I'm honest. So I think it's a challenge for the industry. But that said, I think solo travel from a business perspective is huge. And this sort of leisure thing that I talked about, we're seeing as a trend, people who are on business, whoever it might be, from whichever partner who's away, the others joining them, and they will pick their boutique hotel, hopefully. The companies pick up the tab sort of Wednesday to Friday, and then they'll stay on for an extra night or two. So in terms of solo travel, I don't have any real sort of words of wisdom on what's going to happen. Of course, it must be a huge market. I don't know what the figures are in terms of how many solo travelers there are out there. Do you know that you could help me know? How people accommodate them, I think, is important when they are solo. I know I travel on my own. You know, I speak on my own anyway. That's one for the wife. I can only look at how people are looked after rather than whether I think it's a big market. But I think the way Mr. and Mrs. Smith is set up, we're not set up really particularly well for solo travel.
But what would you look for? I mean, what do you find missing as a solo traveller?
I think deals.
Deals.
Because you find stuff and you think, what a great deal on a great place, and then when you actually go and try to book it as a solo traveller, it's more expensive than anything else you looked at in the first place. So I think that's the first thing. And then the second part, I guess, is a lot of travel is built around couples and romance and all that sort of thing. And I want some other experiences. Oh. I still want to be pampered, but you know, I like to look at sunsets on my own.
All I can say is if you ring us as a solo traveller, we will look after you the best we can, and we would, of course,
get something.
So, yes. Our concierge service might be able to help.
All right.
I've genuinely always thought about doing a Mr. and Mrs. Smith dating site. It'd be brilliant, wouldn't it? Come on, it'd be great, wouldn't it?
There's a your Kindle back. Get lots of people. Is it Tinder, sorry. Tinder is the book.
Tinder.
All right, one Chinese girl, and then...
Call us also, you.
1 minute. Okay, Chinese girl.
Okay.
I think we've set the business up to try and build a brand that the hotels would be proud of putting a plaque on their wall, which we're slowly plaque dominating around the world now. I think it's really difficult for small hotels who are generally not very good at marketing to put themselves sort of in the correct limelight, so to speak, globally. So I see ourselves as championing these small hotels, and so far that's worked really well for us because we are becoming a recognized stamp of approval, hopefully for all you boutique and luxury hotel goers. But if you see our stamp of approval, then you know it's going to be a great
you
hotel.
And that's
stars
or not?
No stars. I hate stars. We don't do stars, diamonds, rosettes. It's all about the experience. We judge hotels by how good the martini is, and can you fit two in the bath, and is the shower going to get you wet, and you know, important stuff like are there sheets, the most brilliant Egyptian cotton.
Baths where you're two people.
It's
very difficult to have one person in a bath which fits two.
Well, I'm just telling you, I think it's important. You can get twin baths, you can have conversations next to each other. Yeah. I can help you with this.
Okay. I designed the room with two loos, actually, adjacent to each other.
I'm not sure that's quite so romantic.
Well, you'd be surprised.
You and I need to talk.
Those are the lonely moments when you need company.
Please don't invite me to your twin.
So, all right, whoever has the microphone first. Go on.
Oh, thanks, Sir David. Thank you. talking about names, I'm an artist.
Just at the wrong time, just before Uber arrived, I believe. Yeah, someone didn't make it to the next week of work. I can tell you, whoever paid that money for Addison Lee. Lovely cars though, but they're in trouble. Yeah.
I know, he's very happy now, he's got loads of money.
I'm sure he is. It was the best handoff I can think of in recent history, so yeah.
Apparently, he was offered 300 million. So,
yeah.
And my question is, as an artist, I mean, do you come a lot, do you see a lot of art hotels?
Yes, it's another trend, if I was to sort of look at micro trends. Particularly kinetic art in hotels seems to be a big thing. So art that's more interactive. I don't know if any of you have been to Ham Yard. Have any of you been to Ham Yard just up the road? If you haven't been to Ham Yard, go and have a drink there afterwards. Brilliant hotel, designed by Kit Kemp. Go to the lift and look behind the lift. There's this wonderful living clock sort of piece of art, which I'm not going to tell you what it does, but go and have a look at it. But it's brilliant. And
what a hidden cop.
No, clock. And it's just little fun, quirky things that keep the guests' attention when you're at reception or waiting to go into your bedroom or whatever it might be, are really interesting. There's another one my kids loved in San Francisco. I'm trying to remember the name of it. Terrible. But they have this sort of basketball scoring sort of kinetic art piece where you put balls, basketballs through a hoop that comes down like like a pinball type thing. But it's all in perception. It's extraordinary. And so we're seeing these sort of installations, art installations, coming up more and more in hotels. And it's fun. I think, you know, the more art, the merrier. One of our new hotel awards categories is the Culture Hub. You see what we did? So it's recognizing hotels that genuinely invite the local community, artists, etc., to really make the hotels the center of the culture of that destination, which again, hotels can transform a destination. really important, and those sorts of areas tend to be where artists live to start with, because I'm sure you've done very well, but a lot of them haven't quite done quite so well yet, maybe.
Okay, quickly, because we've got quite a few of them here. Go on. Whoever grabs the microphone, please.
Okay.
Hello.
You talked a little bit about you gave some hotel examples that are going beyond hotel luxury, and
yes.
Moving it, pushing the boundaries
sort
there.
Beyond boutique, almost, yeah.
And I just wondered what you thought the future of luxury is, and what do you think
Well, there's no question, and we've all been talking about it, so I'm really surprised you, but this experience luxury is becoming more and more important. So I think hotels where we just used to go and fly, flop, and be pampered is not enough anymore. We're seeing more trend into learning skills. So cookery schools, for example, is a big trend in hotels now. Going back to your cookery point earlier on, we want to do things when we're there. I think from a Mr. and Mrs. Smith perspective, it's not necessarily about huge adventure yet. Of course, that's another trend that's happening away from us. But these little boutique adventures, as we're calling them, whatever it might be, catch a fish, bake a cake, do a yoga lesson, whatever it is, these little enhancers to your experience while you're in the hotel is becoming hugely important. And I think that all really stems back to us as humans wanting to make memories and want to talk about things. I think social media is fueling that as well. Interesting, we want to do things and talk to our friends about what we're doing. And so experience, which is such a generic term, but we are as humans seeking out more and more experiences. I think again that's reflected in the pop-up culture. We want the new thing, what's going on, what's hot tonight, what's something I can't get next week, so that's very much being I think dovetailed into hotel experiences as well.
Hi.
Hello.
Speaking of future trends, I hear a lot about the end-to-end passenger journey.
Okay.
And obviously the hotels do a fantastic job taking care of you when you're there.
Yeah.
The airports and airlines do the same, but does that fit in the middle where you're on your own as such? And what do you see is missing, or have you seen any trends emerge, or what do you see as the future?
Yeah, so I think the sort of the seamless experience of from booking to arriving is something that we as travel companies are struggling with, because being humans, we like to maybe start our search for a hotel online, we might change device, we might phone a friend, we might look on social media, we might ring someone, we might call the hotel. We have tons of touch points, and joining all those together to actually create a seamless experience is something that we're trying to do as a company now. And that will be literally from the moment you start your search, do you even think about it? We're now trying to preempt even what you're thinking is where we're trying to go to. So we used to work with data analysts, now we work with data scientists. They're the same people, but they charge more money because they put scientists in front of their name. But we are now trying to predict what you want before you even know you want it. So that's the start of the journey for us now, this very top of the funnel journey. And then, yes, as a company, our ambition is to look after you all the way through that guest experience. And ironically, these hotels, as you say, they're very good at looking after you. They're terrible at knowing anything about you before you arrive, apart from whether you want a restaurant booking or a spa treatment or maybe a different type of pillow in your bedroom. They're not very good at joining up with us, and it's our fault as well, in terms of really sharing who you are and what you want and how you want to be looked after. And that, again, is something that I think in the future we will all get better at as we become closer. And technology will help facilitate that, and it already is starting to do that. So I hope that experiences will just get better and better and more seamless and more effortless. That's what I'm certainly looking for. At spa menus, they don't ask if I'm pregnant. I can't wait until I get to form where they always go, are you male or female? Are you pregnant? Do you, it's kind of all those things that really annoy me.
Ask you to fill in the form.
Any intimate forms, you must have already taken my details. I hate that, and payments and all these.
I think
these
what
things.
You should tell people, the most irritating thing in hotels when you arrive is when you're shown to your room and the person asks you to leave the lift first. And you don't know where to go.
Yeah.
But they always say, please.
Where
am I going? Why don't you just ask them from now on to lead the way and not let you, frown around as to where to go?
I agree. I like that one. I'm going to take that one.
You've been circling around this issue, talking about the or maybe you do have it and I'm not aware, you haven't created maybe a tier or a niche of your customers to offer them the full concierge experience, because the big hotels probably do it for their customers, but as you said, small hotels might need someone like you, and then you could just whisk the customer and offer them an art class or have their portrait painted or whatever, like a weekend where you offer them things.
Yeah, we do offer it, we just haven't delivered it well enough yet. And we have three tiers of membership. We have Blacksmith, Silversmith, and Goldsmith. And Goldsmith is our top tier of member, where it does come with a travel concierge service. So technically, we can organize anything for you. Delivering that is a whole other ball game that we're working on. And we're having some success with it, but I want it to be better. But it's a difficult thing to deliver, it really is.
Hello. Let us squeeze a few more questions.
Yep.
Hi, James.
Hello.
Big fan, by the way.
Thank you very much.
Bit of a slightly different question, maybe a bit personal.
Okay.
Well, let me ask you this. Why are you a big fan? What experiences have you had of Mr. and Mrs. Smith that make you a big fan?
I trust that you will select an amazing hotel for me.
And you have been there.
I have.
Loved it.
Absolutely loved it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Which? So, Sicily, Taormina.
Yep.
Can't remember.
I was there yesterday.
Really?
Yeah. Room 106.
Oh.
She
never
ended.
Last night, my wife and I were sleeping.
Very nice.
In Grand Hotel, I mean, after that.
So my question.
There we go. That's all worked out well for me, didn't it? Segue. You too. Thank you.
Private question.
Okay.
What's it been like building a brand with your wife?
Good question. It's been for us genuinely. Not that she's not here because we're going through divorce proceedings or anything, I promise. We genuinely have grown as a couple together because, I don't know about you guys, but firstly, we work in very separate parts of the business. She's the techie one, she's the CTO, so Chief Technology Officer. I'm now the Executive Chairman, I look after the brand side of things. So I'm very offline, she's very online in the sort of pantomime horse. And when we get home together, we share in all the highs and the lows, and it's been really good for us. It's really bonded us. Occasionally it's hard to get away from it. Genuinely, that's the only thing I would say is a downside. But there's no kind of, hi honey, I'm home, you know, what's in the oven? It's not like that in my house. It's like, hi honey, I'm home, and she'll like, what are you cooking tonight? You know, it's very much like that. What do we eat?
Yeah.
I'm really getting stuck into a lot of different lentil-y things at the moment, trying to take out my potato habits at the moment, which are helpful. But it's been great for us.
Not what you eat. You don't say to your wife or the wife and what's in the oven. So what do you eat?
What do you eat?
How do you always go out?
No, we eat at home a lot. Yeah.
So we
do go out a lot, of course, but we eat at home a lot. Yeah.
Okay.
And I cook more than she does. But it's been really genuinely good for us. We've had a really good time. And also, I don't know you guys, but managing to travel the world with your partner. It's pretty amazing, you know. It's quite something to have to have had to do that.
It should be amazing for a single too.
I'm not going to comment. I'm just going to keep quiet on that one. So yeah, so it's been really good. So I don't have any really bad stories about it. It's been great.
Hi,
just wait.
Hello.
Hi.
Great.
You mentioned earlier on that you have about 500 hotels who are trying to apply to be on the website.
Yes.
What is your criteria to say that is it's Mr. Smith?
We don't have it perfectly written down in a form, because I don't like forms, as you know, from a minute ago. It really is about the sort of intangible often that forms can't tell you. I honestly look at the sort of the touch points is how we judge a hotel. So everything from the moment I arrive, I can tell now from the signage, I reckon, if you're going to be a correct hotel for. You know, that's how early I look at what you are. And then as soon as I walk into your lobby, or the way I've been greeted on the door, whether it's someone parking my car, or whoever it might be, from their uniform, from the way that they talk to me, I'm pretty sure whether you're going to be right for me at that point. We, of course, go through the motions, although some I don't. I remember I did a recent hotel. I got to the hotel. We had an appointment booked with the general manager, and I saw a sign saying coaches park left, and I just U-turned there. I'm not going to stay in a hotel which welcomes coaches. Sorry to be snobby, so I just rang my PA and said...
So signs like coaches
park left means to me that that's going to be the wrong sort of vibe for a hotel. So I can tell pretty soon, and then I look at that kind of the ambience of the hotel is really important. You know, are there places there where you can get away together on your own or together that you feel intimate? Is the lighting just right? Is the smell good? Smells a big trend now. So many hotels are developing their own smells, which is, and I mean that in a nice way, not in your twin toilet way. It's all about how it envelops you and how it makes you feel about how the staff look after you. So one of my favourite hotels is called Suniba Fushi in the Maldives, which sounds very spoiled, but the reason is they don't call their staff, they call them hosts. They host you on their island.
They host, they should pay for it. I hate calling them to the house. I said, if you're a host, pay for my bill.
I'll mention that to them next time I speak, but I like the idea of being hosted. I like the idea, rather than having butlers, which feels a bit subservient, you have man Fridays or girl Fridays looking after you. And I like that you integrate. They have a, rather than a staff area, they have a staff, a team village, a host village. So you feel very much a part of the community. And those sorts of things, I think, as a traveller now, is becoming more and more important to how we look at it. So we look at that awful X factory sort of word, rather than ticking how they're folding napkins, which I'm really
I absolutely know what you mean by you have a feel, you have a sense. I mean, I stayed in as many hotels as I can.
Yeah.
Much of rice and I've had, you can feel it.
You can feel it.
Michael Gondry, the great man who has created the Peninsula Hotel, built the new extension in Hong Kong and asked me to go and try it out for a week, for a weekend. He said that I was a fussy one. So I went and I thought that the whole thing was impossible because he's very gadget orientated in the panels, got 18 switches. And the worst thing is that they're all written with small letters. So you have to go very near and peer at what it is. That's absolutely terrible.
Yeah.
Anyway, I wrote him a letter saying thank you, for the hospitality. And I didn't want to offend him, so I said, excellent. And I said that what I was particularly impressed by was the hands-free phone next to the lavatory. Put a hands-free phone next to the lavatory. So now I can handle two shits at a time. that's a question there and then this one last. One then? Was there none? No?
Okay, the on. Stripes. Stay in the stripes. No? Okay. Okay. The stripes. Oh, I've got one there.
And then one last one from Big Blonde.
Hi, sorry. So you mentioned in the beginning you had to bend your knees to beg the hotels to join your network. So just can you talk a little bit more about that time? I'm still a little bit confused why they would join you.
When we were trying to get the hotels to join originally.
Right, when you had a limited amount of members, what was the incentive?
How did we get the hotels to join?
Or was that before the time of a trip provider, so you were one of the only...
It was really difficult. I mean, I just, again, I think it's, if you're entrepreneurial and really believe in something and have too big a mouth and are relentless in your pursuit to get something working, then you can be persuasive. My background prior to this, so I have quite a checkered history, which I won't go into, but my PR was the only real job that I had before, and I knew we could create a lot of hype around this collection. I had a good feeling about it. I'd spoken to all my friends who I knew wanted this product, and the hotels were just starting to emerge, like Babington House, going back to Soho House. I could feel that this trend was happening. And so when you started to go to these hotels and sell to them and recognize that what they're doing is something that needs to be represented, and wasn't being represented in the right way by people like Relais and Chateau and small luxury hotels and Johansson's and God forbid other ones, AA. I mean, the AA should only fix cars as far as I'm concerned. They should never tell me where to sleep. And so we felt there was a gaping hole and we managed to convince them eventually that we really would, you know, portray them in the best possible light and bring the right type of customers.
Okay, we've got to close very quickly. Last question.
Hi, I just wanted to ask, I know that both you and your wife had successful careers beforehand.
Yes.
When did that moment come that you thought, okay, we're going to jack this in, we're going to do something completely different?
It's a tough question. It kind of evolved. I did have a couple of other businesses that I sort of slowly left behind. I've only ever run businesses for my peers because I understand, hopefully, people of my age. And as soon as I lose love from
afraid we've overrun 5 minutes as well. Anyway, hours passed, and unfortunately, all good things come to an end. First of all, will you please join me in thanking Mr. Smith?
Fantastic, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.